we're going to look at what our part in all of this is. You think about all that God has done for us, how He has called us, how He has forgiven us, how He has justified us, how He has worked in our lives to start to change us, to fill us with His Spirit, all of those kinds of things that He's done for us. Now on this side, after we finish Romans 11, what is our part? What are we supposed to do? What is God calling us to do? And let me say this, it's not optional, although we are urged to do it. We are saved. We are going to heaven if we are truly born again. But if you want to experience a victorious Christian life, if you want to experience all that God wants for you, then chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, and so on, is all about now living for Christ. Now that we have had this great, secure salvation given to us, now that we've been saved, now the sanctification process of us walking in victory, walking in transformation, walking in what God wants us to have in Him for His glory. It starts with these first two verses in chapter 12. Therefore, I urge, beg, beseech, plead with you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves or your bodies a living and holy sacrifice acceptable to God, which is your reasonable spiritual service of worship. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. So what we're looking at here, and you'll see on your sheet there as you want to fill in things, as you're taking notes, we're talking now about walking in the sanctification process. Actually, our part is going to be front and center of what our part is in this journey with Christ, what God expects of us, what God wants from us, and what we are capable of. See, that's the key. This isn't something God is asking of us and urging us to do that we can't do. He's not asking us to do something that He hasn't already done. That is Jesus. When He came, Jesus is not asking us to do anything that He hasn't done already. You see, sometimes you think of someone saying, do what I tell you to do, but don't do as I do. Jesus proved it by going to the cross, dying and rising again on our behalf. But He suffered for the namesake of God Almighty. So, what is our part? What is our part in living the victorious Christian life? And that's what Paul is urging us to consider first. It's almost like if you don't do verses 1 and 2, then the rest of it makes no sense. The rest of the book of Romans doesn't make any sense to us. All the teaching there doesn't make any sense unless we understand and do these things. So therefore I urge, beg, beseech, plead with you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice acceptable to God, which is your reasonable spiritual service of worship. So God starts with our bodies. And when you think about that, that's what God did when He formed Adam's body in the Garden of Eden. He started with the material first and then breathed into that material life. And Adam became a living being, a living soul. And so in the same way, God is asking us, with anything that is part that we have control of in our bodies. I don't have control of somebody else's body. I don't have any control of anything of anybody else. But I do have control over the aspects of my body that I have control over. I do not have a way to really help my intestines digest. You know, I don't have digest that meat right now. Or, you know what I'm saying? Lungs, as you're breathing in, I want you to have a higher oxygen level intake. I don't have control over those aspects of my life. But the things that I do have control over, God is holding me accountable to those things. So when he says, present your bodies as a living and holy sacrifice, he's starting with what we can do, what we started with, what we learned as babies, what we can do. Like all of a sudden we noticed our hand. And think of the things our hands have done. Think of the things that you can do with your body in the material world. So he's saying, surrender all that unto me. Submit that as a living sacrifice unto me. And that means it's a decision. It's reasonable, spiritual service of worship. It's reasonable. It's normal. It's expected. It's a baseline. It's like this is your starting point. Now, most people say I've got to ramp up to that point of being surrendered. Jesus is wanting us to be at the point of surrender when we start this Christian life. He wants us to not think that that's a high and holy thing. No, that's reasonable. That's normal. This is part of your service of worship. This is the first part of who you are. And guess what? It ramps up into spirituality. It's spiritual worship. Me engaging my body engages my spirit. Wherever my body goes, my spirit goes. Do you see how that works? So a decision is being made. My will is involved. My will is involved. My spirit is involved. And my body is involved because of this. And I do this so that he is pleased. My aim is not to please myself, but to please God. I'm doing it so it's acceptable unto him. And in the Old Testament, and this isn't on your notes, but you can take notes, the sacrifice that's being talked about here is like a burnt offering. It's fully consumed. So in this sense, it is fully consumed. Are you fully consumed with wanting to please God? Are you fully consumed with loving him? Are you fully consumed with living for him? That's the picture that we see here is that of a sacrifice, and it's full surrender. It's full surrender unto God. And what am I surrendering? What can I surrender? Well, first, my body. But you know, my brain is attached to my body. It's part of my body, right? And somehow my brain and mind, the spiritual aspect of who I am, connects there. You can't cut open my brain and find where my mind is. But I have a mind and it's related to my brain. I don't understand that, but I'm talking about my brain and my mind right now, which blows my mind. So when you think about that, I'm fully surrendering my mind, my thinking. I'm fully surrendering my goals, my dreams, my desires. Like it says here on the slide here, my goals, dreams, wants, desires, interests, passions. I come up to somebody and said, man, don't you want to worship God? They say, I'm not interested. See what I'm saying? Your interests. What are you interested in? What you're interested in will be like a leash, and it will pull you along to what you are interested in. If your interest is in pleasing God, in worshiping God, in loving God, and knowing him and following him, the interest will pull you. That interest is motivated by his spirit, will cause you to worship him. See? So I'm surrendering my interest. Let's say I'm not there yet. Well, I need to surrender that unto God, my interests. And people are interested in their hobbies, into all kinds of things that consume their lives, that they spend money on, and they spend time on, so much so that I don't have time for the things that God says should matter. And so therefore, I'm worshiping that. That's idolatry. I'm so involved with pleasing myself and entertaining myself, which is called the pleasures of this world, that I'm so involved in that, that that is a living sacrifice. I'm being a living sacrifice unto that. See, I'm going to be a living sacrifice to something, wholly sacrificing myself to something. God is saying, you were designed for that. You were designed to worship God. But if you don't worship God, you will worship something else. And people will say, no, I'm not. And then you should see what they spend their money on. You should see all the hobbies, all their interests. You can tell they're worshiping other things and pursuing other things. You cannot help it. We are designed for that. And this picture here is the brazen altar. It's a picture of a brazen altar. It's probably the one in the tabernacle. And you can see the consumed sacrifice on top. You get the picture. It's being consumed. So that's the kind of love, the kind of devotion, the kind of surrender we need to have. That sacrifice is really surrendered. It has no rights. Doesn't have any dreams or goals. It's going to be consumed. And that's a picture. Doesn't mean that we're supposed to hop up on there physically. But the picture that's there is about a living sacrifice, a holy sacrifice. Now, Jesus didn't hint at this. He directly confronted this. And what needs to be sacrificed? Our old sinful nature. Jesus said this in Luke 14:26-27. Jesus said, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple." Now, the hate here is hyperbola. That has to do with extremes of comparison. And so he's saying that your love for God is so fervent that the love you have for others, because God does command us to love our neighbor, but in comparison, it's almost like a love compared to hate. See, the love for God is so all-consuming. Doesn't mean you hate people. God commands us to love people. But in this context, he's talking about our love for him. If you don't have that kind of love for him, he says, you can't be my disciple. A disciple is one who is saved, who is following Christ, a disciplined learner, who is born again. Jesus said, go out and make disciples. And you saw what they did. They went out and preached the gospel. And when they preached the gospel, people were born again, made disciples. And that's what he's talking about here. Jesus said in Luke 9:23-26, if anyone wishes to come after me, that is to follow me, to be my disciple, he must deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake, he is the one who will save it. Lose his life for me. For what is a man profited if he gains the whole world and loses or forfeits his own soul or himself? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words, you can never divorce Jesus from his words. You can't divorce God from the Holy Bible. The Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his glory, the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. So this surrender, think of the surrender that Jesus surrendered himself onto the cross. And he's saying that's what we need to do. We need to die to ourselves, die to the old selfish, self-centered, self-gratifying, self-deifying, old selfish nature, which urges us on to glorify ourselves. We no longer should do that. We should surrender that and die to that and live for Christ. And that's what he's saying here in this bundle. And we know we can only do that by our bodies. We have to move our body into surrender unto God. And everything that we do now, it's like this. Everything I do with my body now, I want to serve God with my body. I want to serve God with everything that I do and all that I'm involved in. And I want it to be worship unto God. And by that standard, then, that helps us make decisions in what we engage ourselves in, what we do with our time. It doesn't mean you're always on your knees praying, but my gosh, I think we need to pray a little more. And it doesn't mean that you can't watch TV or go to the beach or all those kinds of things, but if those things fill your life and you don't have time for God, then there's something out of balance. In fact, we don't need to be balanced. We need to be radical for Christ. We need to be unbalanced for Jesus. We need to be seeking those things which are above where Christ is seated and not set our minds upon things of the earth. We need to be heavenly minded and earthly good. The earthly good is the gospel. So let's move on to the second verse. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. So he says, don't let the world squeeze you into its mold. Squeeze you into its mold. And what is this world he's talking about? In John 3:16, it says, for God loved the world. Or it's like, God loved the world in this way. For God so loved the world, it's how you would say it in our language today, God loved the world this way, and he sent his Son, his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life, whoever should believe in him. So that world, he gave Jesus to the world. Well, that world there, in that context, same word, that context is the world of people. People. In this context, is the world system. System of values, a world view. The world view, systems of values that have at its roots falsity, fake, emptiness, and its surface. It's the word cosmos. Now, some people will say, well, the cosmos and the galaxies and the stars, cosmos or whatever, but it also is cosmopolitan, cosmetics. And so there's various forms of that. In the old days, cosmos meant a big covering of a surface that might have had pinholes in it. I mean, that's the way they were thinking. Little pinholes, and those are the stars, and there's a surface or canopy. Surface. So there's a kind of a dome and a surface. Remember in the Old Testament, God put a firmament. And there's something of a vestige of that, a firmament. There's a fabric of the universe, right? Well, corrupt that, and then it becomes, that person is just surface. The world system is kind of only surface deep. Do you see where that's coming from? That's what he's talking about here. It's empty, it's fake, it has a layer of falsity. Now, I'm going to meddle a little, but cosmetics, what does that do? It's on the surface, it kind of paints up the face, but it adds and enhances to some folks, and others, it covers them up. And you only see on the surface, but what's underneath you don't see. You see, that's kind of what the world system is. The world system is like that. And it's a system of values that God doesn't approve of. Now think of the Pharisees. Think of the Sadducees and the Herodians. They could put their statement of faith, let's say the Pharisees, and let's say Jesus had a statement of faith, and you have about 98% agreement on a lot of things. But it's that 2% that really controls their culture and the way they value things and what they value and how they do things, how they relate to one another. All the fabric of that culture and society, the worldview, the pressures, what you highly value and what you don't, all of that, that's a world system. And in that world system, Jesus has something to attack. He attacked the falsity. He attacked the fakeness. He attacked the wrong values. He attacked all the things in that that were out of alignment with God. So it's systems of values that God doesn't approve of. And you would think, well, wait a minute. How does that compare to, like, the corrupt Greek culture in Corinth? I mean, rampant, horrible kinds of sins. Well, it was still the world system. It's just a different flavor, a different spectrum. To God, it has to be something that is not aligned with his value system. Should be in the church. The culture within the church, the fabric, the relationships, our values, is really the only outpost of what God highly values as that world, the church world, should be that which is related to God. So why is the world system the world system? Because Satan can't be everywhere. Satan and his demons can't be everywhere. So to mimic a fake omnipresence, they use the fabric of the various aspects of the various world systems around the world. Does that make sense? Because Satan can kind of get ideologies going and false beliefs and get a few people going, peer leaders within a culture, and they embrace those values, and then that ripple effect affects other people through peer pressure, through family pressure. That's why Jesus said, unless you love me more than your mother, father, and all these other relatives, even your own wife, you cannot follow me, because you have to cut off those pressures that are there, the peer pressures, the social relational pressures, governmental pressures, cultural pressures. Satan uses all of that. That's his best weapon to intimidate people with a little bit of fear of saying, if I don't belong, if I don't fit in, if I don't get in, that fitting in is like getting into the mold and be squished or squeezed into that mold. And then that's what Satan uses, another one, kind of like assembly line, making sure everybody's in the fenced in and everybody's kind of toeing the line and nobody's rocking the boat. And that's exactly what Satan wants. Satan wants that because he can't control it all. Think about that. God is always more powerful. That's why he fights tooth and nail against the gospel, because if the gospel gets in there with people, freedom occurs and they'll be set free. And then that can be contagious and cause others to be set free, and they won't toe the line anymore. And they'll upset the apple cart. Doctrines of demons, faults, lies, deception. That's what Satan uses. Remember, he's a father of all liars or father of all lies. He lied and he killed all of humans with a lie in the Garden of Eden. So how do we counteract this? God said for us not to be conformed to this world, but to be renewed in our mind. How do we renew our mind? What is the tool that God gives us? The tools that God gives us to renew our mind. What do we renew our mind in? 1 John 2:15-17. Do not love the world or the things of the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the boastful pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away, and the lust thereof, or the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever. So we're going to see that even in the description of what the world is, you see the description of the world is, where am I looking? I'm looking in the Bible. The Bible confronts us with what the world is. Do I have lust of the flesh? Lust of things that are material. That could be anything. That could be from the sexual side to possessions. Lust of the eyes. I want those things. I got to have those things. That other person has it. Covetousness comes in right there. And the boastful pride of life. They're boasting about who they are and all that they have and how great they are. Very boastful, very arrogant, scoffing. Those values are what's at the core of the world system. Jesus confronted the Pharisees with this fact. Now the Pharisees, who were lovers of money, so he tagged them with what their idolatry is, were listening to all these things and were scoffing at him. A scoffer and a mocker will always find some kind of bad thing in somebody else's life while they excuse themselves. It's a hypocrite. And they have a mask on and saying, you're blah, 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 and you have all these problems, and pointing at them, and if you would toe the line, that's a scoffer. They hear the truth, they scoff and say, nah, when the truth of the Word of God comes. And Jesus said to them, you are those who justify yourselves in the sight of men. So the world system has to do with being justified in the sight of men, that is, being pleasing, so that you get along with everybody, you know, because you want to get along all the time, right? But God knows your hearts. For that which is highly esteemed among men, that is, on earth, in the world system, is detestable in the sight of God. It's detestable. So how do I know what is detestable? How do I know what is pleasing to God? How do I know what God is pleased with and acceptable? I go to the Word of God. The Word of God renews my mind. As I read and study, meditate upon, as I memorize it, as I get it into me, as I apply it in my life, as it gets implanted in me, it changes my mind. It transforms me through the mind to the heart. And that's what God wants us to be, transformed. And the word there is metamorphosis, which is caterpillar to butterfly. It becomes mush, and then it becomes a butterfly. And that is miraculous. Nobody can figure out everything that's going on in there. But The DNA even restructures. It's just amazing what happens in that. Well, that's what God wants to do in our lives, is to transform us. But he cannot do that unless we do our part. And our part is read, study, meditate, memorize his word, apply it, speak it, talk about it. Seek to apply it when you're in decisions, when you're in relationships with other people, to call to remembrance. Allow the Holy Spirit to call it to remembrance. And that's how the Word of God becomes a part of you. Word of God has to become a part of us. Otherwise, we are not going to have our mind renewed and washed. Boy, we need our mind to be washed. Oh, you're just being brainwashed. I'm telling you, I need my brain washed. That is, cleansed of this world's system's values and what it holds to be true. Jesus said, if you abide or live in my word, and you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. It's going to set you free or make you free. It's going to cause you to be free. And free from what? Free to do anything you want? No, free to actually please God now. Free to be who you have been created to be, and free from the power of sin. Free from allowing Satan to control you anymore, any of his values in your life. So you ask the question. Well, let me read this next verse. Sorry. If you abide or live in me, and my words abide or live in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. So there's an exchange going on here. There's qualifications. There's criteria. You meet the criteria, then God does these certain things. There's conditions. Not everything in the Christian life is unconditional. God offers his love unconditionally to all people. But all people cannot experience his love unconditionally. They must meet the condition of repentance and surrender and trusting in Christ. They cannot experience his love unless they meet criteria. In the same way, I am not going to excel and experience a walk with God and him engaging and moving in my life unless I meet these conditions. In some of your translations, say stay or remain or abide. And I translate those as live because the word is can be used with the root of where you live and stay and breathe, your home. Welcome to my humble abode. And so that's where this is. That's why I use the word live here. Am I living in his word? Is his word living in me? Am I living in Christ? Is Christ living in me? And that's what's going on here. Am I living according to his word? 1 John 1:22 through 25 says, "But be doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves." So I have to practice trusting in God, obeying God with the word that I know. What sometimes we have too much of what we know about the word of God to actively obey. It would take us the rest of our lives to obey what we know. And so get going, and we need to do what God has shown us. Because if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man looking at his own face in a mirror. Now listen to this, because there's going to be another passage that relates to mirror. Okay? The other passage we're going to look at relates to mirror and looking at a mirror. And in both cases, freedom occurs. Okay? So this one has to do with the mirror of the Word of God. For he looks, verse 24, for he looks at himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he is. But the one who looks intently, okay, now listen to this, looks intently, actively engages, deeply searching, there's energy involved, it's not casual. This is intentional. I'm looking, I'm searching, I am deeply, deeply looking. Looks intently into the perfect law of freedom. Perfect law of freedom, based on the context of everything here, is the Word of God, verse 22. So the perfect law of freedom is the Word of God. Just like Jesus said, you will know the truth and the truth will set you free if you abide in his word. And his word is the Bible. He has definitely said in John 17:17, your word, O God, sanctify them in the truth. Your word is the truth. So we know that what he's talking about here is the Word of God. Perfect law of liberty, or the perfect law of freedom, and perseveres in it. That means even when you don't want to read it, even when you don't want to study it, you persevere and go through it. And you still reap the benefits. You still are intently looking. You can't get around what he's saying here in verse 25. He is exactly saying this. And is not forgetful here. That is, how am I not forgetful here? I'm not forgetful when I memorize it. When I memorize it, I will never forget it. If I engage it, talk to others about it, preach on it, teach on it, help others with it, if I can remember to quote it, if I read it, quote it, every time I do that, the more it gets into my brain cells, the more it gets into my heart, the more it gets into me. He says so here, and is not a forgetful hearer, but one who does good works. That is, now it's become part of me, now I'm doing it. I'm doing it. I'm motivated by His Spirit with the Word implanted. God is using that Word implanted to motivate me. This person will be blessed in what he does. Memorize, study, meditate upon, live accordingly. A renewed mind, renewed by God's Word, cleansing, washing. And what he does, it's supplanting. Jacob was called a supplanter. That's what it meant, to supplant, or heel catcher. But to supplant, to replace. So as I am drenching myself with the Word of God, reading, studying, engaging myself with it, it is replacing those values that were those values and ideologies and ideas and thoughts and ways of thinking with God's Word and what He wants me in the way I should be thinking, the values He wants me to have, the goals and dreams He wants me to have based upon His Word by His Spirit. I'm replacing. They compete. God's Word competes with the world system. And so, point by point, whatever the world system has is some point in my life that the Word of God should replace. And that's what he's talking about. Replacing, transforming me as my mind is being renewed. My mind is renewed by his Spirit, by his Word. His Word being implanted. And then the more of the Word I have in me and as part of my life, the Holy Spirit can use in my life more and more to transform me. And why is he transforming? Because I need to be more like Jesus. He wants me to be more like Jesus. Jesus is the image who I am being transformed into. He said this in Romans 8, and now he repeats it. Being transformed by the renewing of my mind. I must engage. The part that I have to play in the transformation of my life, all of us has to play in our lives, relates to how much my quiet time is. How much I pray and read the Word and study it, and where the Word owns me, where the Word comes in and lives in me. To that degree is the degree of my transformation and my love for Him more and more. Now remember the mirror, remember the transformation, remember the freedom of the Word of God looking intently. Now look at this aspect in 2 Corinthians 3:18. We all with unveiled faces are looking as in a mirror at the glory of the Lord and are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory. This is from the Lord who is the Spirit. So, as we are studying God's Word, memorizing it, going into His Word, engaging, praying, prayerfully studying His Word, God is revealing Jesus to me and my need more for Jesus. And as I surrender more, as I fall in love with Him more, as He reveals more of Jesus to me, I'm looking at His Word and reading the picture of Jesus is implanted in my life, and that's how I'm changed. Unveiled. It's no longer veiled. The Word of God is not veiled anymore. And I see both the written Word, but the living Word of God, who is Jesus Christ. And that causes me to become more like Jesus. When Jesus is revealed to me more in and through His Word, that is how God changes me. But I have to be in His Word. When I see Christ on almost every page in the Bible, when I start seeing that happen, when I start seeing the life of Joseph and I go, wow, the life of Joseph reminds me so much of Jesus. I see a mirror. When I see David, I see a mirror of me and how sinful I am, but also how needful I am of God, and how David has a little bit of a type of Christ there. But also David reminds me of me. And when you look through, you see the mirror of yourself, the mirror of your need for him, and the mirror of Christ is like reflecting the glory of Christ to you. And that causes me to be more like Jesus. The renewing of my mind. When God's word takes over me, when God's word starts doing this in my life, when I start to be more and more transformed into the image of Jesus, hopefully that is happening in our lives. The result is God's public display of proving to everyone loudly of substantive evidence that God's will is good, acceptable, and perfect. God's will is good, acceptable, and perfect. It gives, gives evidence. It shows as a result God's public display of proven evidence. If you go throughout history, you could see God transforming lives with the power of Christ. But they also had a part in it. They also had to devote themselves, surrender. Surrender themselves to Christ. Jesus said it this way. In the same way, let your light shine before men so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. As God starts doing this transformative work in our lives, we will do things that are good. And as we do those things that are good, people will see, wow, I kind of want that. When they start seeing God's will on public display, they will see that transformation and change in our lives, good, acceptable, and perfect. Think about that, good, acceptable, and perfect. Let's kind of lump that together. Wholesome, fulfilling, satisfying, pleasing, enjoyable, sustainable. That God's will in a person's life, following God, is good. It's the best. That's what he wants to put on public display in our lives. As we surrender more, that leaks out in us more, and people will see that satisfies, that perfect. Perfect means complete, but it also means, wow, that was a perfect meal, and it satisfied me. I'm complete. I'm satiated. It's wholesome, good. It's got goodness to it. And acceptable, meaning it's pleasing. Not just pleasing to God, but pleasing to people, to that old vestige image of God that we still have, that sense of justice, that sense of righteousness, that sense of good and wrong. And we look at that and say, you know, that's good. I remember when I was at high school, there was this one just on fire Christian. And he was always be nice to me. He was always nice to me. And he was on the wrestling team and I was on the football team, and we didn't do a lot of stuff together, but sometimes we'd lift weights together. And he would talk to me about God, and there was something about him that God had worked in his life so that it was solid. It wasn't wishy-washy. I was wishy-washy. I really did. I thought I knew God. I kind of read the Bible. I was kind of liked maybe God or not, but I was more moving toward atheism, and it didn't seem real to me. But he was real. I always remembered, I like when we went for our jogs and our runs and our lifting weights. There's something about this guy that really attracted me to something. I couldn't put my finger on it. But now, looking back, it was this. It was wholesome. It was fulfilling. It was satisfying. He had joy in his life. It was something about sustainability. He was in it for the long run. And when people ridiculed him, oh man, there were people who ridiculed him and scoffed him. But when he took somebody down in the wrestling circle or rink or whatever, people cheered him on because he was, you know, our school won because of him, you know, or whatever. So he persevered through all of that, and he was shining. And then the kinds of things he and his church would do to help, like the poor and stuff in Long Beach, California, where I lived, and other kinds of things they did for a funeral for one of the kids in the football team who died in the car accident. There were just kinds of things that he did. It was like, you know, as a person, as a human, I really wouldn't want to be doing those things. But then I look at it, it's like, wow, what he was doing was good. And overall, that's what we should be like when people look at us, what God is doing in our lives as we get more in love with Jesus, as we fall in love with him more, is that God leaks out in us, and the wholesomeness and the goodness and his, that satisfaction can provoke even the sinner to jealousy. So that I want that. There's something that they have, and what I have is empty. And that's really what God is talking about here, is getting us to the place where we prove to the world what God's will is, good, acceptable, and perfect. And it's not us trying to make it happen. Our goal is full surrender, reading and studying his word, and seeking to obey it, and allowing God to do the rest, the miraculous. Amen? So let's stand and let's sing to God this last song.